also, I'm just really doing a sound check to make sure people at the back can hear. If someone at the back can sort of wave to tell me that, that they can hear reasonably clearly, that's excellent. We've got a series of faces on now, the cameras will start to run. Good evening and welcome to this meeting of Wirral Strategic Planning Application Subcommittee. My name is Stuart Kelly, I'm the chair of the committee. This meeting will be broadcast and a record obtained on the council website. For people at home viewing the webcast, if you look above the meeting, you will see a resources tab. Select this and the link to the agenda will appear on the right hand side. This will enable you to open the agenda report as PDF. My role is to ensure that the meeting runs smoothly, having regards to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who are with us, planning and departmental officers. They will present the application and provide any technical advice that may be required. The council solicitor. They will give advice on any procedural or legal matters that may arise. There is also the clerk and IT support. Elected members will consider the application and collectively make the decision. Voting will be by show of hands. The application report will be introduced by the planning officers. I will then invite a representative of qualifying petitions to address us. I will then invite ward councillors to speak. I will then invite the applicant to address us. Once all representations have been made, and following any questions or clarification from members, speakers may not participate in any debate that follows within the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members, and we will then make a decision on the application. When making their decision, members must have regard to the provisions of the Planning and Compulsory Purchase Act, which requires decision makers to only have regard to material planning considerations. Members must also have regard to local planning policies and to the National Planning Policy Framework and Guidance. The National Framework makes a presumption in favour of sustainable development. Paragraph 11 requires approval of development proposals that accord with an up-to-date development plan without delay, unless the adverse impact of doing so would significantly and demonstrably outweigh the benefits when assessed against the policies in the National Framework taken as a whole. It's a matter for each member individually to balance any material considerations and to decide what weight to give them. Members must not predetermine any matter which comes to the committee for decision. However, it is permissible for members to be predisposed toward a particular outcome with regards to the application, provided they don't make up their minds on how to vote before formally considering the application details, listening to the presentations and the full. Members must have listened to the debate and considered all the facts before deciding whether or not to remove any motion. If a member's mind is to put forward a motion, it's good practice to first seek advice from officers on the wording of a potential motion. Members will have noted that the officer recommendations for refusal were some reasons listed. All options are open to members once they've heard all presentations and debated the issues, either to agree the recommendation or refuse, or to reach the conclusion that the application should be approved. Members are reminded to use their microphones when speaking, and if everybody could turn their mobile phones to silent, please. Agenda item one then. Apologies for absence. I'm aware of Wayne Carmaker and George, your deputies. Thank you. Agenda item two. Members' code of conduct, declarations of interest. Members of the committee are asked whether they have any personal or prejudicial interests in connection with the application on the agenda, and if so, to declare it and to state the nature of the interest. No, excellent. That brings us, hopefully swiftly enough, onto agenda item three, land to the east of Glenwood Drive, Irby, outline plan application for residential developments of up to 290 dwellings. I'd ask the planning officer to introduce the item.
Thank you, Chair. May I have slide 3, please? So this is now an application with all matters reserved other than access for a residential development up to 290 dwellings with associated infrastructure on land to the east of Glenwood Drive and Area. The application is one of 7 applications submitted at the same time by the applicant for more than 750 dwellings. As the chair notes, the application is recommended for refusal and officers have prepared a detailed report in which I'll detail the key issues. So the application site is located within the Greenbelt, both Wirral Youth and E-Policy GB2 and the National Planning Policy Framework broadly states that the construction of buildings in the Greenbelt should be considered inappropriate and that such inappropriate development should not be approved unless there are very special circumstances. The proposed development does not fall into any of the exemptions listed for appropriate development in the Greenbelt. The proposal would not preserve the openness of the Greenbelt, would diminish open views of the countryside and would change the character of the immediate surrounding by introducing built development where none previously existed. The proposal will therefore clearly constitute inappropriate development. As noted, local and national planning policy states that inappropriate developments should not be allowed unless there are very special circumstances. The MPP states that the harm to the Greenbelt must be clearly outweighed by other considerations. The applicant contends that very special circumstances do relate to this proposal, and these are listed in full in section 3.7.16 of the report. They include the contribution of the scheme would make to Wirral's 5-year housing supply, the provision of 30% affordable housing and 20% biodiversity net gain, both of which are greater than required by policy, and the inclusion of open space and supportive provision for the wider community. These have been carefully assessed and, in summary, are not considered to form various special circumstances individually. Many of the elements stated are standard policy requirements which would be expected from any large housing scheme. Even cumulatively, the benefits put forward do not clearly outweigh the harm to the Greenbelt which development will cause. The proposal is therefore unacceptable and is contrary to Wirral Youth and E-Policy GB2 and Section 13 of the MPPF. The Council formally submitted the Wirral Open Plan to the Secretary of State for Independent Examination yesterday. The plan states that sufficient brownfield land exists within urban areas of the Borough to ensure that housing needs can be met. And it concludes that exceptional circumstances to justify alterations to the existing Greenbelt boundaries do not exist. In accordance with the MPPF, the Council is required to identify a 5-year housing delivery supply. And the latest published calculations set out within the Council's strategic housing land availability assessment 2021 shows a 6-year supply and an initial calculation at April 2022 indicated 5.9-year supply. Officers are therefore satisfied that the Council can meet the requirement for a 5-year housing supply. In terms of landscaping, there's also considered to be a clear negative impact on the landscape of the area. UDP policy IM1 states that proposals will not be permitted where their visual impacts will be inappropriate in terms of character, appearance and landscape setting of the area. Whilst it's acknowledged that existing trees and hedgerows are largely to be retained throughout the site, there will inevitably be harm to the landscape area from the introduction of significant built form in the form of new dwellings upon undeveloped fields. The applicant's landscape and visual appraisal acknowledges harm to the views within the area, but notes that this harm will be reduced by year 15 of the development. The Council has commissioned its own appraisal, which concludes that there will be moderate or major impact from the scheme. And overall, it's concluded that the proposal will have an unacceptable adverse impact on the rural character of the site from a landscaping perspective, as therefore contrary to development UDP policies and the MPPF. The development will also be built predominantly upon agricultural land. The applicant has submitted a report relating to agricultural land classification. This identifies that 9.4 hectares of the site are classified as grade 3A, which is included within the definition of best and most versatile agricultural land. This equates to approximately 58% of the agricultural land on the site, which is considerably higher than Natural England estimate that nationally 42% of agricultural land is best and most versatile land. Wirral UDP policy AGR1 states that the local planning authority will seek to prevent the loss of best and most versatile agricultural land, while policy AG2 states that applicants must demonstrate the extent to which it will be practical to retain the land to its former quality. If the development took place, in this case, the land clearly would never return to its former quality should the development be granted. Mitigation has been proposed in the form of a soil resource management plan to reuse displaced soil resources on site. The applicant acknowledged there is some harm due to the proposed loss of agricultural land. However, they consider that this must be balanced against the overall benefits of the scheme. In officers' opinion, it's not accepted that the benefits of the scheme outweigh the loss of agricultural land, especially given the extent of best and most versatile land to be developed upon. An application is therefore unacceptable in relation to policy AGR1 and AG2 of the UDP. The site sits within an area where there will be a 20% affordable housing requirements. The development proposes 30% provision, and therefore the proposal will comply with this, although it's noted that this will have to be scored by 616 agreements, which is not being provided. Although the application is at outline level, the mix of dwellings shown indicatively includes a broad range of dwelling sizes, including 1, 2, 3 and 4 most bedroom units, and this is broadly considered acceptable. Slide 4, please. In terms of design, the youngsters of layout are generally well considered, although there is some concern that the applicant basing their design approach on previously unit developments that caught sunlight and dawn above could be related to the pastiche of these historic villages, which actually devalue the special character of the villages. Regardless, whilst these are considerable concerns, it's noted that the application is at outline stage and this could likely be resolved in the reserve matters application. With regard to highways, the proposed development will be served by two accesses onto Thingwall Road, for which approval is sought under this application. These accesses are considered acceptable. The application is supported by a transport assessment which concludes that Thingwall Road East and Hensby Road Junction would require improvement works to deal with the additional traffic, whilst the cumulative impact on the Arrow Road and Arrow Brook Lane Junction would also mean junction improvements are required. Additional works are proposed or required, including a bumper control crossing over Thingwall Road, enhancements of existing public right of way across the site, and a cycleway through the site and along Thingwall Road. Given the inclusion of sport provision on the site, which may attract non-residents, traffic calming on the main spine road of the site may also be required. Whilst the application being at outline stage only means that many of these issues could be dealt with at reserve matter stage, insufficient information has been provided in relation to the specific condition on legal agreement wearing. In addition, National Highways will have a statutory remit with regards to the M53 and request that further information be submitted in relation to the impact of the development on junctions 3 and 4 when taking the cumulative impact of this application and the six other applications. This information has not been received. The ecological survey which has been undertaken have been summarised within the submitted environmental statement. However, the full survey reports have not been provided and this is considered unacceptable. A number of designated ecological sites along the coast are easily accessible from the application site. Given the number of new dwellings proposed, this will likely result in increased visits to these sites, bringing associated recreational pressure. The application documents concede that there is potential for likely significant effects as a result of the increased recreational pressure. The applicant references the proposed site of alternative natural green space being proposed, but this does not yet have planning permission. In any case, this and any and the other on-site open space provision is not considered sufficient to offset the likely recreational pressure impacts, yet the applicant has not suggested or agreed to any of the mitigation measures. Given this, and the absence of full survey reports being submitted, the proposal does not comply with relevant UDP policies or the provision of the MPPF in relation to ecology. With regards to drainage, the applicant has submitted a flood risk assessment and drainage strategy. This has been assessed by the legal and flood authority and the environment agency. The conclusion is that this aspect of the development would be acceptable and it would not increase risk of flooding off-site subject to the imposition of safe conditions. In terms of sports provision, whilst the application does make provision for outdoor sports, Sports England currently objects to the application on the basis of the cumulative impact of the seven applications submitted together, which results in nearly 800 new dwellings. Whilst the applicant disputes Sports England methodology, this matter does remain unresolved and has not been resolved. Had the application been recommended for approval, then there would have been a requirement for the applicant to enter into a legal agreement to secure contributions or details in relation to sports provision, highways works, affordable housing, open space and point provision, and ecological contributions. In addition, there's a known shortfall of school places within the area. A legal agreement to secure these has not been completed, and the proposal therefore does not comply with UDP policy 2 or paragraph 58 of the MPPF. In conclusion, the proposed development is considered to constitute inappropriate development within the Greenbelt, which would have a harmful impact on the character and landscape of the area and would result in a significant loss of best and most raised out agricultural land. In addition, insufficient information has been submitted in relation to highways works and ecological matters, including the mitigation required to offset recreational pressure. And the proposal would therefore recommend the refusal for the reasons set out in the form at the end of the report, and just noting a minor change on the addendum list to remove reference to grade 2 agricultural lands for review. Thank you.
appreciate this isn't a full plan, this is a strategic application subcommittee, and there's a lot of issues with large applications like this. So I'm not going to interrupt your flow, but when we get to about 5 minutes, if you're repeating yourself, then I might ask whether we're coming to a conclusion. Is that okay?
Yes.
Excellent. So, around about 5 minutes for you to introduce the petitions.
So, I'm a resident of Parkway in Irby, and I've lived there for more than 23 years with my family. Many residents, not only of Irby but across Wirral, strongly object to any house building on the beautiful green belt. I am aware of the need to build additional houses, and I know that the Wirral plan, which is currently under review, includes plans to build a significant number of new houses, which will be more than adequate to meet the future needs of the Wirral. The houses will be built on brownfield sites, which have already been identified, and will be in locations where the housing needs are greatest and will make most sense in terms of employment opportunities, and I strongly support that plan. I'm very privileged to live where I do, and I appreciate that every day. The open countryside is used on a daily basis by walkers, families out enjoying the fresh air, dog walkers, horse riders, many rambling groups. And this beautiful area provides much needed space for exercise in the open air, which is so important for physical and mental well-being. The land provides shelter and home to a wide variety of wildlife and birds, and building on these open green spaces could lead to a loss of large numbers due to the destruction of their habitats, and will have a significantly negative impact on the ecosystem, including the closure of the green and wildlife corridor currently in place. There are no flooding areas in this issue from Arrowbrook, of which I'm sure you were aware, and the loss of this open land would surely only make this problem much worse. And additionally, there could also be a danger of pollution to Arrowbrook from the development. This is agricultural land currently in use by the tenant farmer. We're all aware of the need to protect farming and agricultural land, food supply issues which have become apparent to us all, highlighting the need to increase farming and food production in the UK. This development would mean the loss of agricultural land, and as such would be in conflict with rural policies regarding the protection and improvement of farmland. Furthermore, the threat to the environment, of which we're all aware, makes it imperative that we protect our green spaces in order to counteract the issues around global warming, and a proposed development would fail to meet the rural climate change mitigation policy. Neither Hume Estates wish to build in the first phase 290 houses. Given the poor transport links to Irby, which is one bus and no train stations, and with little or no job opportunities in the area, it's reasonable to assume that each household will have at least one or two cars. This could lead to an additional 400 to 500 extra cars on the roads of Wirral in this small village area. The levels of additional pollution and damage to air quality would be significant. I understand that Wirral already has a worryingly high level of lung disease in our children. There would also be considerable risk caused by the additional traffic. You may be aware that Thingwall Road, providing access to this proposed estate, has had many traffic accidents previously, including sadly some fatal accidents. And several years ago, so concerned were the council that they considered introducing severe traffic calming measures, including speed bumps and built-out pavements. And that gives an indication of the concerns related to traffic in this area, and I believe illustrates that residents will be negatively impacted and made less safe by the likely significant increase in traffic. I'm also aware that the local GP, as well as other GPs across Wirral, have little or no capacity for additional patients, and there is no NHS dentist in Irby. 290 additional houses could mean around 1,000 people needing GP hospital and dental services, and there is little scope in local schools to be able to provide the additional school places that would be required. There are many sites of ancient and archaeological interest in this area, including evidence of a Roman road which crosses this site, and also evidence of a Roman British settlement. These sites need to be preserved and protected. Finally, as I mentioned, I've been very privileged to live in this location, but this area is not only enjoyed by the local area residents, it's appreciated and enjoyed across the whole of Irby, Thingwall and residents beyond. Building on this beautiful greenbelt land will destroy the character of Irby, and it is a against the purpose of Green Belt, which is to prevent merging communities. With no infrastructure to support this application, I strongly implore you to reject it. Once the Green Belt land is taken and built upon, we can never get it back, and it will be gone forever. Please don't take this Green Belt land away from the current and future residents of Wirral. Thank you.
Greenbelt. There'll be a loss of agricultural land, loss of food production, land and food security issues. There is no need for new housing in this location. It is contrary to form and purpose of the Green Belt, and there will be negative impact on the community infrastructure. Such developments will contribute to urban sprawl, which will impact on local character and the loss of the local distinctiveness of villages. Lastly, I want to say this very loud and clear. Our Green Belt needs to be preserved for generations to come and not used for short-term gains. Thank you, Chair. Yeah.
So it's clear that our policy, our planning policy, is against building on the Greenbelt in general. So I think it's important to look at this application via the very exceptional circumstances. Now, these are listed as both as part of the UDP and in the National Planning Policy Framework. And the design and access statement given by the developers does not refer to any of them directly or indirectly, as far as I can see. One of the examples given is for limited infill in villages, so that would be apparently an acceptable reason to build on Greenbelt. But this is not limited, it's not infill. This is the size of a small village, you know, in and of itself, that would disrupt the boundary, or rather erase the boundary between the clearly defined Irby and Greensby. So the references that the design and access statement does make to what it considers to be very exceptional circumstances are the much needed housing stock. But we've seen, as we've heard, that we've got a 6 year or a 5.9 year supply on Brownfield. And the second reference is to a biodiversity net gain of 20%. But from the report, we can also see that Natural England have objected to the proposal on biodiversity grounds. So it's clear that this development does not prevent sport, and it comes nowhere near to meeting the very, very special circumstances that are listed in the National Policy Planning Framework and in the UDP. So I don't see how we can support it or any scheme of such a similar size.
Speeches from the ward councillor and the
objectors. I think the lots of emotion around and what you'll find in the planning committee is that we have to devoid ourselves of some of the emotion and stick to the hard and fast planning issues. And the reason for that is that possibly the applicant can appeal, and we need to be seen to stick to what are material considerations. So that's probably why we will appear a bit drier in our language rather than some more emotive issues. However, we come back to some of the basics, and the basics is that the land is designated as green belt. It fits the purpose of green belt by any description, and we've heard numerous descriptions in terms of separating communities, in terms of agricultural land. And that was the case when we developed our unity development plan. And I take a little bit of personal pride and pride on behalf of the council that UDP has stood us in good stead in terms of protection of the green belt. I worked night after night going through the unity development plan, page by page, area by area, designating pieces of land for what they were. And the designation of this piece of land was quite clear at that time and remains absolutely clear that it is a green belt. So therefore, the policy that is in play at the moment, and we've heard much talk about the emerging local plan, which is a consideration, but the heaviest weight in terms of consideration must be with the here and now, and that is the unitary development plan, which I say. And that unitary development plan was debated and worked out by many councillors who don't have any green belt in the ward. It shows that the council recognises the value of the green belt wherever it is and wherever you represent, and that UDP stands us in good stead. We then look at the actual things around what you can put in green belts, and you have to demonstrate that harm will be caused. But no one can be in any real doubt, can they, that a beautiful field and its surroundings, by simply putting 290 houses on it, must cause harm. And we've heard about harm to agricultural issues. So clearly the demonstration of harm to the green belt has been demonstrated by the officers and ourselves. We then come on to very special circumstances. I do not believe that simply building houses is a very special circumstance, especially when we know that we can build in other places less harmful. So it doesn't meet that criteria. There have been in the past very special circumstances in rebuild. I'll quote one going back many years. Our park hospital, for example, was built on a designated rebuild at the time. People could make an argument for very special circumstances. I would be hard-pressed to make an argument for very special circumstances for simply building houses, and that would be a difficult one. So, we have come to the conclusion, I think, and the officers have done a very thorough report, and I accept the addendum about the classification of agricultural land. My view is that the planning committee, sticking to its plan and policies, the here and now, and hopefully the emerging local plan, that we will be in a good position to easily defend these reasons for refusal if there's any forthcoming appeal. So my view is that the green belt, this particular piece of green belt, should be protected, and it's the job of this planning committee to serve the people of Wirral and stick to the planning rules. We can do both tonight, and I would be supporting refusal. Thank you.
For me, the most relevant question tonight is this. Can a housing estate, by definition, ever satisfy the prima facie condition when considering any planning application for building in the Greenbelt of not being harmful to the Greenbelt? Any building in the Greenbelt where there has previously been none cannot, in all logic, fail to have greater impact on the openness than the former non-existence of development. Therefore, any form of development on a swathe of greenbelt land can only be seen as counterintuitive, as it is contrary to what one would intuitively expect. Paragraph 148 of the NPPF states that substantial weight should be given to any harm to the greenbelt, and that very special circumstances required to build in the greenbelt do not exist unless they can be outweighed by other considerations. Paragraph 138 of the NPPF states the five purposes of the greenbelt, all of which would be negated by this application. I am not convinced in any way that it is possible to attribute the very special circumstances required, notwithstanding all other conditions that can be considered in this application, to a housing development of whatever size and design that fails, in my view, to overcome the prima facie requirement of not causing substantial harm to the Greenbelt or to the openness and spatial awareness of the Greenbelt. In view of the aforementioned, I will be supporting the recommendation by the planning officers for refusal of this application. Thank you, Chair.
Any developer, including the human states. It's It's been referred to finally then the very clear harm that will be caused to the openness of the green belt in this location and the risk of urban sprawl resulting as it would in the merger of the townships of Irby and Thingwall. The applicants have proposed a number of matters they consider amount to very special circumstances, and these are analysed in detail in the appendix, in appendix one of the report. And I agree with the case officer that none of these amount to very special circumstances, and all of them represent standard issues that will be applicable to any housing application that may be before us. The applicants have brought nothing to us. They're not here for us to challenge them some further on what they feel are special circumstances. So we can only take the analysis that's in the report, to which I agree. I agree entirely with what speakers have already said. I don't want to keep people here any longer than they need to be. I will, from the chair, move the officer recommendation to refuse for the reasons listed. Including the amendment to refuse the reason three on our addendum.
Happy second.
Yes, thank you for the vice chair second. Any other members wish to make a contribution for the vote on the substantive resolution? Okay. Voting will be for, against, or abstaining on the motion to refuse the application. See those in favour of refusal, please.
That's
unanimous,
Chair.
Members of the public, that application has been refused. For the avoidance of doubt, members of the public will be aware that this obligation has come to this committee because of its size, 290 dwellings. The decision notice will be issued tomorrow, which is the deadline for the council to issue its decision notice on this application. And as no new issues have been raised that affect the decision notices for the other applications, a two will be issued tomorrow morning, and all the legal applications will have been refused.